I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Can you bring up the agenda?
Anybody out there kneeling?
Thanks. Roll call, everyone's present tonight. First item, approval of the agenda. Did we have any additions, Marty, or no?
I think I do under the administrator's report, but my mind is on the budget right now, if we can just leave some flexibility there.
I'll make a motion to approve.
I'll second it.
Motion made and second, all in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed, same, motion passes. Open forum.
Carol Dittman, 10059 County Road 47, St. Cloud, Rockville. I just want to report that Tracy Stevens, the person involved with selling 401 Oak Street, is really actively pursuing a buyer for the property. There's been 8 different people that we've been in contact with regarding that. So I don't know that I'm going to be able to stay for the whole meeting. I don't know if it's going to be brought up later, but I just wanted to make sure that you knew that she is actively working on it.
Okay. Thank you. Anybody else? Sue?
I just want to extend a thank you to the committee who worked on that veteran monument. I mean, they did, honestly, I don't know if people were able to attend that, but they did a superb job, honestly. It was a really, really nice ceremony and a pretty short time in which they got that monument here to the city of Rockville. So I don't have the names. I don't remember everybody who was on the committee, but I just want to say thank you to them.
I think that feeling is mutual for a lot of people in this community. It was a great day.
Heard nothing but good things, absolutely.
Yes, I heard from people outside of the city, too, that were here, that seen pictures. Everybody thought it was an excellent thing. Very good.
Yeah. I'll make a quick comment. I did videotape it from the roof of the fire department. Nick had taken me up there. And I got a good video, and I got it on YouTube. I haven't gotten a copy over to Tri-City Cable yet, but hopefully we'll get that. This weekend.
That should look pretty sharp.
Yeah.
And Sue, if I could just add a footnote, I was down at the League of Minnesota Cities yesterday, and the state executive director caught it on news, I think it was Channel 9 news down in the metro area, and several of the people that were on that committee that were there had seen it. So it got widespread review from many different places, so we should capitalize on that.
Okay, next item, approval of the August 17 City Council minutes.
Make a motion to approve.
I'll second that.
Motion been made and second. All in favor say aye.
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 Opposed, same. Motion passes. Approval of bills paid, item 7.
Make a motion to approve, but I'd just like one clarification, if we could get that. The repairs for the water mains, the saddles, could we get that broke out, the 3 different, or did they just send one bill?
I could have lined itemized it. You would have seen it then. I can do that in the future, and I can forward you the 3 invoices if that's helpful.
Just before we go any further, I had that same request today during the course of the day, and Marty, in your absence, Judy researched that for me, and there is no major breakdown whatsoever on that invoice.
Okay.
So that was going to be my request also. And the reason for it, because we had 3 different water main breaks. 2 of them are not water main breaks, sorry, water mains curb stop and
saddle
repair. One of them was in non-water area, so we can use that as a basis. So if they would split up that invoice to say on the three different ones, get that one and use that as a typical, and that's what I was alluding to earlier with the subject matter of Stoney's, you know, or some of that as the value that we could use for that.
I'll look into it.
Okay.
Okay. So did we have a motion?
I made a motion to approve.
I'll second it.
Motion been made and second to approve the bills paid. All in favor, say aye.
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 Opposed, same. Motion passes. Item 8, consent agenda.
I would make a motion to
approve. I'll second.
Motion been made and second to approve the consent agenda. All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Opposed, same. Motion passes. Department's report, Sheriff. Good evening.
Thank you. Good evening. So August report, we had 32 total contract hours, a little less than normal. We ran into a few days where we were quite busy and couldn't get into the contracts that I had scheduled. So kind of going through the different types of calls. Starting on the first page there, 1057, or intoxicated person, really ended up being a mental health evaluation. Abandoned vehicle was actually a motorcycle in the park. We looked into that, got a hold of the registered owner. It was just parked there temporarily for whatever reason. I had a bunch of alarms. They were all false alarms, nothing legit there. We did complete three more alcohol compliance checks in the city in the month of August. One of them failed, two other businesses passed. Had several animal complaints. Some of them I wasn't able to find information on, and what that typically means is it was a barking dog or a dog at large, and by the time we show up, it's not around anymore. But you did have one dog that we sent a letter to as potentially dangerous out on County Road 138. It came out kind of aggressively chasing somebody. Seems like the owner has taken care of what they need to, but it's registered at our office as potentially dangerous. You did have some abandoned property, a bike that was found over, I think, on Lake Road, and then getting down to the burglary, it was your softball shed. They did identify some, maybe it was a different one, hang on. No, we do not have any suspects on that case. It was somebody broke into the softball shed, took 50 softballs and some other things. Don't really have any leads on that one at this point. And you list all the contract hours, getting down to couple more dog complaints. Both of them were dogs on the loose. Both of them ended up being contained. No real issues there. A number of driving complaints. Nothing really significant to note there. Found property. It was actually a raft that was adrift on Pleasant Lake, I believe. More of these fraud complaints. I don't remember if I mentioned it at our last council meeting here, or I've mentioned it at other council meetings as well, but another one of those scams, fraud complaints that we are cautioning people about. I think we mentioned it at the last meeting. This one, actually, the second theft complaint that was born out of that was actually a stolen credit card information, not the credit card itself, but we did identify two subjects in that had charged a lot of different things locally here, and we do have criminal charges pending on two people out of that, born out of that same fraud case. We did have one juvenile party where several citations were written, several medical emergencies, some noise complaints, nothing real significant there. All the suspicious activities and suspicious persons that you see down the list there all were resolved, nothing really remarkable, ranging from somebody that was homeless to kids out playing Pokemon or anything like that, but nothing really significant. We had one theft that was actually theft from a family member, one family member stealing from another. We got that resolved and actually charged that out. And then a threats complaint that really wasn't a threat. I don't remember what I categorized it at, but it wasn't as what it was reported. I think we had about 50 traffic stops, handful of citations. No DWIs in the city this month that I was able to find. Yeah, that's about it.
All
I have a question for you. When your officers are patrolling in like suspicious vehicle, I know lately we've had some maintenance had to pick up, I think it was out on the Sauk River Road where some garbage in the disc, like a whole stereo complex and stuff like that. And I mean, if they've noticed that in the ditch or not, that maybe they can correlate the two together. I've just something maybe to pass on to them. I don't know if that, how that would work.
It's possible. If you guys have, if you come across like that doing cleanups or you come across some illegal dumping, certainly call it back into our office and we can investigate that as an illegal dumping complaint. Right. We can check our previous calls to see if we had any suspicious activity like that. You know, looking through these suspicious activities, to be more specific, one was a door-to-door salesman. One was kids walking around doing Pokemon is what they told us, which is probably true. One was a broken down car. One was two vehicles stopped talking to one another. Another one was a security vehicle going through town. And another one was that abandoned motorcycle. So, you know, on the face of it, I don't know that any of those would necessarily match up, but certainly right. Call those back in. We will take a separate report as an illegal dumping complaint and investigate that. Like
because that way, let's say that they drive out and they found something laying in a ditch, some large item laying in a ditch tomorrow. And like tonight they drove, there was a vehicle there. They have to have the plate number or something in there, kind of access to
yep.
That's fine. That's
and you can either, at. You know, you can do that like we have in the past, either call it in directly or call it into Marty or, and he can get it to me and we can have somebody come out and check
yeah,
that.
Because we'd like to get them because that can be, that's an expensive item for the city hauling that stuff all away. We try to look through it. I know Nick and they look through it, but sometimes they throw a dresser out or something. Maybe it happened to be a name.
Yeah, so, oftentimes we'll come across a piece of mail or something that'll identify who it's. But yeah, just certainly please call those in and we can at least try to find out whose it is.
Okay.
All right. Thank you, sir.
It's actually a little unrelated to you, but do we ever do offer a citywide kind of cleanup day? I know other cities do it, and I don't know if that helps with any of the dumping of, you know, stuff, but.
Yes, I have experience with it.
I think Cold Spring just advertised one recently or something.
I'm familiar with my previous two previous cities ago. They paid for it. It was worth it to them. They got two roll-offs out at the compost site. I don't know if we have a compost unless we talk about Jerry Tipple's place, but put two roll-offs out there and one day the public could bring all their garbage. And it was monitored to make sure it was junk, not household garbage.
Yeah.
It was a great asset to the community.
Yeah. I think sportsmen used to be involved. Stearns County used to come out and take paint and everything. Okay. All right. Thank you. Next item, City Engineer Dave Blumholz, 2017 Street Project.
All right.
Have a good night.
I left some light reading in your council packets there for you guys with the 2017 Street Improvements Project here. Yeah, there's a PowerPoint for me.
I think that's PDF, isn't it? You can try.
Yeah, it's PDF of the report. All right.
Will that be okay?
I can make that work, sure. I didn't bring a backup copy of my PowerPoint, and that's not a norm for me, but such is life here. All right. Basically, I have pretty good news on the 2017 potential street project here. The soil borings we got on Lake Road, Sauk River Road, 245th/88th, and there was one more that's in fairly good condition. Sauk River Lake and 82nd, 83rd, 263rd, that combination north of the Pleasant Lake lift station. We got some pretty good news on some of those soil borings that the subgrade conditions weren't quite as bad as we had always thought they were in that area, and that's why we did those soil borings. So in the report, I was actually able to go to a reclaim and overlay on those portions with some reconstruction in specific locations where we have subgrade failures that we can tell by the cracking out there. So in the end, like I said, I think it was a pretty substantial savings to the project, but to be able to go with those improvements in place of the reconstruct improvements, which would have been in the estimates that we talked about in the preliminary and the capital improvement plan. So this will be a fairly straightforward but large construction project. Bids have been pretty good lately for these type of projects, so certainly we're in the area where it might be prudent to do that work. Here's a quick, if you look on table two here, just a quick summary of the streets we're looking at, how long they are, and some particular comments out there for me. So as I mentioned, there's a couple of streets that we're going to be able to do almost a strict reclaim and overlay with very little patching. That's 245th/88th Street. Sauk River Road is also in that category. Sauk River Road is going to be a little bit more of a challenge because that road is so broken up as it is. Reclaiming is difficult when the pieces are that small. So there's going to need to be a little bit potentially of extra mixing on that one. But still, I don't think we're to the point where we need to do a reconstruct out there based on what the subgrade soils tell us and the geotechnical report said. Hybrid approach being Lake Road and that 82nd, 263rd, 83rd. On Lake Road, I'm figuring about 20% reconstruct, 80% reclaim and overlay, and that's based on what I see out there and what the soil borings have told us. 82nd, 263rd, that segment there, that got a hybrid approach because there is little class 5 underneath the existing aggregate out there, or under the existing bituminous. So what we would do is we'd add supplemental aggregate on the surface, grind that up, and then overlay it as well. So it becomes a type of a reclaim, but we're going to add some aggregate to make up for what's lacking now. Reconstructed streets, these are ones that certainly weren't a surprise to me. These have been noted as having poor subgrade soils before, and nothing surprising here. Ailes Road, Grand Lake Road, and Chestnut Street. Chestnut Street, we would be stuck with a reconstruct mostly. There's some water main improvements that need to be made on that street as well. Estimated costs. I know you guys were planning in the budgeting meeting there. We ended up with about $3.25 million for the total for these projects. Now, it would be an option certainly to go through and prioritize those and move that project around. But as we've talked about, we've got a backlog of projects here. This was on the list for improvements, and this is what made the cut for the time being. Like I said, I'm certainly open to modifying that, but this was the recommendation at this point. Assessments. This is a little trickier subject here. So in the past, we've assessed 27% of the schedule of costs that's approved annually associated with our assessment rolls. And because of the specific parcels we're assessing on this project, with the 200-foot cap on agricultural land, and also several of the roads were only able to assess one side because we only own one side of the roadway, that is going to make that 27% not adequate to bond for the funds. So we end up assessing slightly more than that 27%. It'd be about 35% of the reconstruction cost is where we'd be at approximately. So that number is, and that's going to have to vary by project, and the bonding requirements are what's going to drive it. So we will keep those assessments as low as possible, and I think that's what you're going to end up seeing is something in the neighborhood of $18 a foot for our assessments.
How do we handle that versus our policy? Can we exceed our policy by need to meet that bonding requirement?
Sure.
Okay.
Yep.
The rate, as far as the rates, actually the rates that are in the assessment policy are probably adequate. The percent we're assessing, you know, we've always gone to that 27%, and that's been kind of on a project by project basis. In the past, we haven't had to deviate from it because we weren't bonding for the funds, so we never had to actually achieve 20%. Our goal was to get close to that 20%, and when we have, like for instance on Berg Street, where we have properties that own both sides of the roadway all the way up and down, we got more than 20% assessed because we were at 27%. Just specifically these roadways, we just don't get it because of that 200-foot cap on ag land. And like I said, Grand Lake Road, we got one side to assess. 82nd, 263rd, 83rd, that one is also only one side assessed because we actually managed to own the whole roadway, but the only one side is in the city.
On the portion of Grand Lake Road, though, is part of that Maine Prairie Township's responsibility?
And that is the case, yes, on
and
that.
How does that factor then into, so is the $334,000, which is what I think it said for Grand Lake Road, is that the entire cost?
That is the entire cost.
So does the part Maine Prairie pays count, can that count towards that 20%, meeting that 20%?
It certainly could. That's a negotiated portion. It would be less we'd have to bond for, so then our assessment would come up. Our assessment would be based on that schedule of values, so we're going to get X number of dollars based on that.
Well, or do you,
would we decrease our bond is the question.
Or do you bond for it and count their portion as, or can you count it into how much we're collecting? Can it go towards
could
meeting
we,
the 20% so that we don't have to assess other people more than 27%?
I don't believe that it can. I don't believe we can assess Maine Prairie Township. Now, could Maine Prairie Township assess their residents and pass it on? I don't know the answer to that. Because that would be that would be kind of a pass-through assessment that we'd be looking for from the township, and that would have to be a negotiation with them. At this point, it's kind of worst-case scenario to show the whole improvement on our dime here, and certainly that wouldn't be my intention, because that's not what we're looking to do out there. So that's what's happening on that one. Like I said, 82nd, 83rd, and 263rd is kind of a unique scenario when it comes to assessments. We took on the entire roadway when we annexed for Brentwood Hills, the entire roadway, but did not take on the parcel immediately west or south of that roadway. Only north and east do we own. So that becomes that's a pretty difficult one. It's another one that one is not extremely well traveled, and if you had to make me pick one to take off, that would be it. But it's in terrible shape. It's basically one giant crack fill out there if you drive it. It's all crack ceiling.
Which road?
The one that heading north, pretty much straight north of Pleasant Lake.
By the lift station?
Yep, north off the lift station, west of Brentwood Hills. So that one became difficult as far as getting that assessment percentage up as well. In addition, Sauk River Road, it's hard to assess the rivers, so we can't get all of that. We've assessed Stearns County for what we can. And we are allowed to assess another government agency, so we can do that. There are ways they can get around paying it, but they usually do. So I've assumed they will at this point. So potential schedule for this improvement. I have the feasibility study before you guys this evening. You could certainly receive that feasibility study. It's one of the official items in the 429 assessment process. And next step before we start ordering plans or anything like that is to hold the actual public improvement hearing, which is hearing one of the assessment process. We could do that October, November, certainly anytime you guys would like to do. We do need some time for mailed notice and that kind of thing to residents. Following that meeting, the council would take feedback from the residents at that public hearing. And then at that point, you could order plans and specifications to be prepared. And I put together a bidding schedule based on advertising that could get us to award in March. And in the past, we've seen some high numbers based on bidding too late. So this is a timeline intended to avoid that. February is a great time to bid projects in this state.
Could I recommend the council pencil in November 16th for a potential public hearing for assessment?
In which case, we'll formally receive the report and order that by resolution at the October meeting would be the way to officially do that. So an awful lot of information in this packet. I certainly hit just the highlights here. I'd be willing to take any questions, or certainly since you guys aren't accepting it, we can call this a draft. You can catch up with me between now and the next meeting. I can make any tweaks or revisions you'd like to see.
At what stage can they not add or subtract streets?
Once we have the official order of the assessment or order of the improvements, then we couldn't add any more at that point. But following the public hearing, the initial public hearing for the assessment process, the council could remove streets from the project and only order plans for streets 1 through 4.
So is that the October meeting then that they can't? November. They can add streets up to the November meeting? No,
after October.
October.
We would be done adding.
And so for your consideration then is the discussion in the town hall meeting on Pleasant Road. Just a comment.
So, Dave, what's the like asphalt charge in that? Now, has it gone up this year? Is it even out, or what's it doing right now? Or what does it look like potentially for next year? I mean, it's such uneven, but I've heard different comments. Some said it's gone up, some say it's staying down, so I don't know.
It's definitely down from where it was 2 years ago. I think when we did Berg Street in 2012, we paid over $70 a ton. I've certainly seen bids come in as low as the upper 40s this year for some of the cheaper mixes. In this area, for this kind of work, I have estimated mid-60s. I think that's slightly conservative, but I think that's where I'd want to be at this point. Do I think it could come in a little lower than that if we were to bid it right now? It potentially could. But I think we're going to see a fairly level market, because I don't see oil prices going back up, but I don't have the crystal ball either.
Like that mix now, we use a half or a three-quarter inch mix?
We'll use a three-quarter inch mix for the base, half-inch mix for the wear course.
Wear course, okay.
Yeah, and basically our changes that we make to those are the quality of the asphalt that we actually add to them, whether we use a low-temp asphalt that resists thermal cracking or that kind of thing, $7, $8 a ton difference. So it's a value, value calculation whether we do it or not. I would generally recommend it in the wear course just to avoid that thermal cracking because we're doing this new road. Let's do it right. That's how the estimate is written as well.
Do you work with any, you know, so I'm just thinking about our assessment policy and what we've done with sort of our rural land, which is basically assess them the equivalent of a city lot, yep. Right? And I mean, certainly if you have a lot of frontage, you could argue there's a more benefit. They're getting a road, right?
Yep.
So I guess I just, have you worked with other cities that have, you know, that type of situation? And what are they doing on their assessment?
Rockville is so unique with its large geographic footprint. I don't have anybody that caps assessments due to agricultural land. But at the same time, I also don't serve any cities that have that really as a major contributor. So every assessment policy is different. This one is fairly straightforward, which is fantastic. And that 200-foot cap, and that was the intention, was to limit that to the, you know, the residential portion of that parcel would be 200 feet. Otherwise, we're looking at 1,300-foot assessments for the same chunk that we're now assessing for 200 feet.
I guess, though, I'm wondering if there should be something in between. I mean, I'm just aware that it creates issues for potentially bonding. And you certainly could make the argument that there is a benefit if you own, say, 1,300 feet.
Yeah.
I
wouldn't disagree with that benefit.
So I'm just putting that out there.
Yeah. Well, the other area is the 27.
If it's going to limit us bonding every time we, you know, are looking at trying to do street projects, I think it's just something we need to do.
It is certainly going to be a factor in every rural street we do.
The other area is a 27% number, too. That was reduced a number of years ago. I call it arbitrarily as a result of, I think, this road that went through here or something. I think most cities are 30 to 35%, aren't they?
Or more.
Or more.
And yeah. There are certainly cities that don't assess as well. I mean, it runs the gamut.
Yeah.
I would say that
two different areas you could look at. I think.
I do have a specific question, if I could,
yes,
Dave,
sir.
On the opinion of a probable costs. Digging in deeper in your report.
Yeah.
The Sauk River Road.
Yeah.
I got a call from a resident that lives on that road, and apparently they have inside information. The staff person or their son works at the county, and there's drawings that show that. Road being already in a drawing stage or something like that at the county level, and it does not have guardrails. And so as soon as I got that call, I forwarded that inquiry to our administrator, to Marty. I don't know if Marty, if you followed up on it, did anything more about it, but there's a lot of different people. And then there was we had talked about, and Don certainly was involved, armoring that Sauk River itself, putting armor along that side. So are we duplicating, is there tandem work going on? We're doing the city stuff, and is there other entities that are working on that portion of it? Or is there joint?
The last I heard is that it's in the hands of the Army Corps of Engineers. Once we get the permit approved, I can then seek funding and take it to the county for design.
The DNR, it's in the county, Soil and Water, giving us a shoreline design. That's what you sent to the DNR, right?
I sent the entire project.
But that was the basic. That's the only design part that was done because that has to be repaired. And then after we get that approved, then we can make the road design.
To my knowledge, Stearns County hasn't done anything with the street itself, only that culvert and the bank, shores of the Sauk River, the bank of the Sauk River. But that's certainly something to look into. If there has been more on it, let's hear about that.
Well, you know, it seemed bizarre, and then another spot with the watershed district, because it's the Sauk River, they have that on their radar screen of tickle thing coming down. Yep. And so we just had our meeting last night up there, and he said, anything happening on that? I said, there's a preliminary report, and I really dug it in today, and there was nothing about armoring. So I'm just standing, is that a separate issue entirely?
It is.
Okay.
Yep.
And that would be with the Army Corps or with Stearns County?
We're talking about the railings now?
Talking about the culvert repair.
Yeah, no, the armoring on
side,
yep. Which should not necessarily be a city, but somebody will argue to point that the river was there before the road, and if the river happens to stay where it was supposed to, we wouldn't have this problem. But
my understanding,
we don't have much control over that.
Is the city is responsible for this project. We were the ones going to have to seek grant money. We're the ones that are letting it out for bids. That's what I was told.
So we're like the fiscal agent to try to get everything. And then if there's additional funding that comes through from MPCA or
other sources, yeah.
Okay. I think there's a comment. I don't know if you'd
catch a comment. Do we need a motion to schedule a public hearing? Or
yes.
What?
For a public hearing for what now?
For the streets or... Is there an action item?
For that October meeting?
No,
we don't have action
item. No, we'll schedule the public hearing with your blessing for that date I gave you, November 16th, I think it was.
At which point we'll do the formal action in October.
Okay.
But I did sense from our engineer, though, that we should, you know, obviously this is a big chunk of change.
It is.
And hopefully this report will have some shelf life so that we cannot fund this all in one year, obviously. And even if there was a bond sold for everything or something like that, there should be prioritizing. And who is that going to be or something like that? Is that staff and public works? Is there going to be council participation?
No, it'll be you. David will have a spreadsheet showing you what the cost breakdown is for this project.
And then we will ultimately make that decision in terms of prioritizing which ones go first.
I think we kind of did that already. We're at 3.2 million, you said?
Three and a quarter approximately.
And so during the budget portion of this workshop, we were using 3.5.
Okay.
Next year. So we're under what we were budgeting for. So I'm not anticipating you cutting anything. I anticipate you considering adding a street.
And I think all council members and mayor probably hear it. The roads are in dire need, and different people have a different philosophy to what degree, and including staff, you know, or something like that. I've heard that. So it just seems that somewhere along the line there will have to be a decision made in terms of all of this isn't going to be happening in 1 year, all this work.
That is the idea, yes.
Oh, it is?
Yes.
That was my intention.
We can cut stuff from it, but we don't do that tonight. But
that's
the preliminary plan, is
okay.
To include all what Dave's covered, yeah.
But okay. I just sensed
right.
That.
Thanks, Dave.
You're welcome.
What? Jerry wanted to.
Can I make a quick comment?
Yeah, go ahead.
If this assessment policy is in place, would it not seem right, being the county has parkland on both sides of that road, that you'd get some help from the county on that road?
Yeah, there would be county assessment against the county.
Correct.
Yep. All right, thanks, Dave.
Yep, thank you.
Next item, administration, Marty.
Are you ready to tackle the preliminary budget, or do you want to table it to later in the meeting? Are you running to bring it back up?
Yeah.
Okay. Right. Then go up to here to file. Recent. Oh, okay. Whatever one you say. Okay, so on that preliminary budget then, what the last number we came up with is a 25% increase for a preliminary tax levy of 1.414140.
414 what? 140?
Yes. And so for action and first, further discussion, then the action would be to approve resolution 2016-35, adoption of the 2017 preliminary tax levy. with that number unless you lower it or raise it.
Could we provide just a little explanation of why it's going up and what we may be looking at between now and when the final approval is given?
Absolutely. At the beginning of the budget workshop, staff showed you that when we take out all the new stuff that was being proposed for this year, we're actually $10,000 less than last year. So then we brought up what we've been discussing as staff and council. Number one was a transfer out of tax dollars, $85,000 from the general fund to the water fund to help the water fund pay the water tower debt. We took out the $10,000 for Rockfest. It was a consensus of the council that we want Rockfest to stand alone on their own, and that we did put in $200 to account for staff time, mostly for public works providing assistance with closing streets and so on. Then the other items for the council to consider was staff request one for a third full-time employee for the streets and parks. The council at this time did not put that in the budget, but asked staff to see if there was ways to save contract time and money and use that for an employee. So staff will look into that. Then on the, in the middle of the spreadsheet is the wish list. So the council preliminary is setting aside $200,000 for road and bridges. Previous years you had set aside $250,000. We're estimating the bond costs for this 2017 street project to be approximately $250,000 plus some other. I think we had a salt shed in there.
Was public works building?
Was the public works building in there?
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
And a plow truck.
And a plow truck. And again, let me stress: this budget is nothing more than a guideline. It is not an authority to spend money, and it never is. Even in December, when you approve this budget, you still have a spending policy that has to be adhered to by staff. Personal protection equipment. The council fire chief was requesting $20,000. The council changed that to $10,000 for two pieces of equipment a year, but did ask us to check with the chief if that would be okay and safe. The fire chief is requesting to spend $26,000 on equipment next year. And on the far right, we're showing we're going to get that money out of savings to cover it. So that's not causing a tax increase. So that's the primary major reasons for a 25% preliminary tax levy. And the public should know it's preliminary. We have until December to set the final levy. So right now, if you're comfortable with those numbers, the preliminary tax levy is 1.414140.
I'll make a motion to approve the preliminary levy.
I'll second it.
Motion been made and second to approve the 2017 preliminary tax levy. All in favor say aye.
Discussion. Please. In that process that we have at the 20 earlier during the discussion, we were targeting for 20. Later on, and this was in the workshop, a 20% increase. It now increased to what, 25%? That's the magical number that we have at this stage of the game. Is that what I heard?
Yes, sir.
25% more than last year.
Yes, sir.
Now, we did have a very limited amount of increase in the previous years that we talked about earlier. I think it's wise for us to talk about the fact that we had a very, very limited amount of increase. So we invariably had to have, but 25 is a large percentage or so. And of those few that I feel in our dialogue that we had, we could not necessarily get it down to the 20%. I think that was a target that we started with. So when the time comes, I'm going to just make sure that we're aware, if we go with the 25%, that we have some great dialogue between now and December to try to continue to bring that back down to a more realistic number or something like that. This is huge, huge. There's going to be enormous amount of phone calls.
It is, but I think it's helpful to also say, for people who don't remember, and I think to say where our levy was, but, and I said this during the workshop, when we, years ago, when we lost all our state
LGA funds,
mm-hmm. we basically took almost all capital out of the budget. Well, that's not sustainable from a city standpoint.
I agree.
And eventually it catches up to you. And, you know, people will say, we need road repairs. Obviously, we eventually have to replace equipment. So I think, you know, we're trying to look at ways, and I think through bonding is one way to do it, where you can level some of the costs, expenses of this. So I think between now and then, also looking at the rest of our debt and looking at how our payments, you know, in the next, you know, 10 years, how does that all look and how do we think about what's needed in the city to try to get to a place where we don't have to have, you know, big swings in what the tax levy is. But I think there's no doubt that, you know, we can keep pushing it up and eventually you have to do some of it.
Mm-hmm.
All right. Rick, go ahead.
I agree with Dwayne's comment, and I think the reason we went back up to the 25% from the 20 is because we can only bring it down. We wanted little bit of leeway so that we have these things to work on from now until December. So it's not that we're going to have a 25% increase. This is our preliminary that we can work on and with, you know, take those things out and hopefully get it down to the 20.
Yeah, and we actually started the workshop out with 28% on the board, so we were down between 18 and 28, and ended up 25. So motion.
I'd like to make one last comment. If that's the case, it sounds like Mr. Tallman, with some certainty, feels strongly that there is a movement in the direction of the 20 rather than the staying at the 24. I don't know if he has the pulse of the other members, but I'd like to have that same comfort level, and I don't. So anyways, I just stated that.
Motion made second. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed, same. Motion passes. Next item, Marty.
Mr. Mayor, council members, right now you have our two public works employees in the random drug testing pool. That's an annual cost of $75 plus the cost of the drug testing, which can be $150, $200. And it's not required. Just saying, do you want to keep them in the pool or get out? I'm good with a consensus here. I don't think it takes a council.
And why are they in the pool to start with?
I don't know why they were in there.
I don't see any reason why.
I don't know if we've ever had policy established on that, have we? Maybe
no.
Staff, prior administrator just did it.
I don't know either.
Do you need a vote on that, Marty?
No.
No? Okay. All right.
The next item, Mr. Mayor, is 9C3, skate shed and sand. Staff is asking the council permission to remove that shed through demolition. I believe it's been talked about a couple of times.
This is at the rink?
Yes, sir.
What's the sand?
The sand is inside the rink. At one time, there was talk about making sand volleyball in the rink.
Oh.
So what I need from you is, if you want sand volleyball, that's great, but you can't, it's almost impossible to get ice on there then because the water goes through the sand. So you act on this tonight and you say move the shed and remove the sand, that's going to be gone by tomorrow. Because you got a nice ice skating rink there. Do you want ice there this winter if it's a nice winter or not? Where I come from, the outdoor rink is highly and well used. I don't know. I don't have that pulse here if that's the case. But you got a nice rink.
That rink, back before previous maintenance, when your sand was in there, it's very hard to get flooded because it's sand enough. It takes a lot of water just to get the sand itself frozen and put on. And over the last years, I think the amount of skating on there has been very, very limited. We spent more effort flooding it and taking the snow off than people skate on it. I think most of them probably go to the indoor rinks or maybe, and there is not that many, I think, children up in the area of Rockville that use it right now. But that one year, there's a lot of money, time is spent trying to get it to grade to get it to usable. And like the shed can definitely go. That's junk. I mean, it's rubbish.
If you want the rink flooded, I'm asking to remove the sand.
Yeah.
If you don't want the rink flooded, I would say then we don't need a rink and sand volleyball. The one out at Pleasant Lake, to my knowledge, after 6 years, I haven't seen anybody use it. And it's a nice facility.
It just gets used.
It does?
Good. If it gets used, it just makes sense. Take the shed out and take the sand out and see what happens. I make a motion to that effect.
I'll second that.
Motion been made and seconded to remove the skate shed and the sand. All in favor, say aye.
Discussion, please. And there's a reason for my concern here. Moving forward, the Park and Rec, and I had the oversight of Park and Rec for years. The Park and Rec have constantly been trying to get that completed, and they wanted to expand the capabilities of it. So that little bit of sand that's on the top of it is not the detriment when it comes to creating the amount of water that it needs to do if it's done properly. We had some great volunteers in Rockville for many, many years that did that job of volunteering their time to get that water. And we don't have that privilege at this stage of the game of those great volunteers. So having said that, if we're going to put out ice out there whatsoever, we aren't gaining a thing by taking the sand out. And that's a strong, strong feeling that the Park and Rec group have said for years and years. Park and Rec was disbanded in terms of input. They would be out here and extremely irritated if we turned around and did that. I think it's a better thing. Get rid of the shed that you're showing up there. It was donated, the labor on it, by Willenbring Construction many years ago. $0 to the city. And it's time for it to disappear. The more important thing is, let's not put any water on there. There's nobody using it. We've flooded it for years. Nobody's using it anymore. Society has changed. So leave the sand in it. Don't flood it. Get rid of the building. Simple as that.
What are we going to use? What's the sand for there? What's it going to be used for if it's not used
for summer? For summer, we just went and had two volleyball sets that were just prepared this year yet for the purpose of having summer volleyball in that particular area.
Did somebody just say nobody's using the volleyball courts? And somebody said there's demand for a skating rink, right?
Not here.
Most of the skating rink?
No skating. Nobody's using skating rink.
Last year it did not get flooded, and I think that's because of the warm fall and beginning of winter. I have no history to know whether this community uses a skating rink or not, but you've got a nice facility for it.
Could we go... Even though I seconded your motion, could we ask Park and Rec and have them come back with a recommendation?
This is not a special event. This would be staff recommendation to council. This is Nick's request to remove the sand. It isn't going to cost more than an hour's worth of time to get the sand out of there, and he'll pile it. You want it back in someday, it can go back in.
So the purpose of removing the sand is to flood the rink this winter?
Easier flooding.
Well, why not? I mean, if we're not, nobody's using it the way it is, and there's a chance somebody's going to use it if it's successfully flooded. It takes an hour to remove the sand.
I think.
Why don't we remove the sand?
I think it's going to be a little longer to remove the sand than an hour.
Oh, whatever.
But the sand has to be removed if you want to have an ice skating rink, because that 2 or 3 years ago when it did, they spent a lot of time taking the snow off. Then the first 2 or 3 times, the sand just absorbed it, unless it's absolutely cold, before you finally got ice to form. You have to have that black dirt or whatever is underneath there so it don't go away.
I think you're doing kind of a moot point here. I don't think we even need to flood the ice rink because the consensus I heard is nobody's really using it anyway. And if I recall right, the sand was just put there, I'm going to guess, about 3 years ago.
Correct.
Yeah. It has not been long.
No. And there's been very little, and new boards were put up at that time with, I think Paul Worth was in charge when he got sent to serve people. They put that all up.
That's right.
They put it up, and they wanted so that they could also use it for volleyball. But I've never seen volleyball nets or anything else brought up there, or somebody advertising or promoting volleyball there.
Actually, the boards are a hazard to volleyball.
Yeah, they'd be a hazard, so that volleyball wouldn't be the best thing.
So we got...
There's a motion second on the floor.
We got a structure there that somebody put sand to play volleyball, but nobody's playing volleyball. We got a structure there to have a skating rink, and nobody's using it for a skating rink.
Right.
So what do you want to do, just let it sit?
I'd recommend you remove the shed and the sand, and we flood it this year and see what kind of activity we get.
Yeah, that's what... That would be my thought. We did a three-year experiment with sand and volleyball, and nobody's used that, so we've had problems flooding it, and that might be the reason why nobody's skating there, so it makes sense to try flooding it and see if somebody will skate there. All right, let's put it to a vote. There's been a motion and a second to remove the sand and the shed. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Take a roll call.
Aye.
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 Nay.
Nay.
Nay. Motion passes 3-2. Next item, Marty.
Mill Street Water Main. There was originally three complaints. It's now down to one. I have not got an updated estimate on the repair. The estimate, I think I forwarded, is it in your council packet, $17,000 for two of them?
Yeah.
Yeah.
I don't know what to say. What was the bill total for the alley, Dwayne? What was the grand total of that we paid for those three over there?
14.
For three of them?
Yeah. You said $14,300+.
Yeah. For what's that?
Yeah.
That was the three repairs.
Three
over
repairs.
Here.
So we could do council action not to exceed eight. So I give me some room if a quote comes in, or wait till next month. I think the property owner would like to have it looked into. They're concerned that it's so expensive because the water main is close to the shed. And they're going to have to do a lot of extra work to prevent that dirt from falling away from the shed. I think the question for you is, I think we got to fix it.
Yeah.
So I think the cost is irrelevant, but for council action, I'd say not to exceed eight.
Not to exceed what now?
Eight.
8,000? I think it's got to get fixed, yeah.
Repairs not to exceed 8,000.
Second.
Motion made and second to repair the Mill Street water mains not to exceed $8,000.
Can I get some clarification on that? Is it the actual main?
We're assuming it's the curb
court. Mill Street water main. That's what I'm looking here. There's nothing in my prepping to tell me what's the nature of it. Is it a service that's going to a house? Is it a curb stop? Is it a...
We won't know until we dig it up.
Okay.
We are assuming it's the curb corp again.
Okay.
The saddle again?
But we won't know. The property owner knows. Again, we're going to dig it up. If it's your expense on your private line, it's your job to pay the bill.
Okay. Follow-up question to Mr. Administrator, and that is, you alluded to earlier, there is a protocol or a value that's established as to gallons per minute and also pressure. Is that in a written fashion someplace? And if it is, I'd like to have it forwarded to me.
I called the city engineer and asked what type of number of gallons per minute he told me. And we were dramatically under that, so we started the process of looking into it.
So we don't have any written criteria?
I don't think
so. Next time that we have a different public works employee goes to a house, analyzes it, and that was exactly what we had asked for 2 months ago, is to have a specific written criteria so that we have a minimum amount. If it's designed for 55 pounds PSI under this section spread from the water meter. Obviously, when there's a lot of water going on, you're not going to have 55 pounds PSI. So we have to be below that substantially. Then we go a step further and say how many gallons per minute. Once that's established, then we can determine. Otherwise, we're going to have a floodgate of people that are going to call in, and everybody's going to say, we have inferior quality of quantity of water coming into the house. Please check it. Then the next street will call in the following week, and there'll be that much more. So we have to somehow or another stop this evolution that's going to happen. I just know this pulse of this community. So if we have a criteria that says we will come out there and we will analyze how much water pressure that you have at the water meter. And if it's not up to this written criteria at that stage of the game, then we said yes, it goes forward. We have way too much liability. We have way too much flexibility at this stage of the game.
This is a day-to-day operations yep. issue. That comes under my jurisdiction, and I feel the policy is working. Nick went and checked the three complaints we got, and two of them have been resolved.
Okay.
On that policy.
And to that end, when a city council member asked for that written comment, we have voted on it some months ago. That's a request that has not been yet fulfilled at this stage of the game.
I'm not a recall of any vote.
We did.
Council Member Duane.
Yep. Well,
what I asked for, if we could do this in private, if we had issues.
Okay, great. We'll have that.
Okay.
With a spirited conversation when the time comes. Okay. Yeah. My phone is available, but not the next day or two.
All right. A motion been made and second to approve the Mill Street water main repair. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed? Same. Motion passes. Next item.
Mr. Mayor, council members, the fire chief informed me this week that the generator at the fire hall is all but shot and wanted to try to make some repairs on it. I asked him not to do that until I came to you. It needs to be replaced. So I think the worst case scenario is you have in your packet one quote for a generator, and with tax it comes to just under $24,500. And he's going to be looking into a used or new. And my question to him and to Mike Hoffman, and Mike can speak to the issue, is are lives at stake if this generator is not running? And the answer was yes.
What kind of a generator is this? Is this like a propane generator kicks in when the power's out?
This generator is about a 30 kW generator, and it has operated with propane up there. And when we lose the power, that's when the generator starts. And just to give you a little history, it is an integral part to the city of Rockville. When the power goes out, the siren, the fire hall, the garage doors, etc., are used. The fire hall is used and was used during the windstorm or the blowdown that we had in town, where we didn't have any power in town. And what's nice with it, with the generator, and is very important, that is our emergency operations center. And we need to have power there. The city can work out of there, which is part of our plan, and they can do the continuation of city business. The other thing is, it's a valuable asset, because if we don't have power in town, it can also be used for a warming center or a cooling center. So it is our only building in town with a generator backup. You may ask the question, the generator that we use for the city lift stations is a three-phase 277 480 volt generator. This is a single phase 240 volt generator that we have up at the fire hall. The generator itself is over 45 years old. It was bought and it was a backup generator, I believe, for a chicken barn. It has been up at the fire hall for 10 years. The last couple of years they've been limping it through, and it is to the point that there's several major issues with the generator, everything from some internal engine leaks to some wiring issues where the mice have gotten into it. So our reliability is not there. We have, the fire department has run tests up there where they've tested it and the generator fails to start. And yes, right, it is right. Very integral to our emergency plan.
We can accept that it's failing, so it needs replacement, so we don't have to go on and on that. Who gave you that kind of price on that generator?
Ziegler.
For the 33 kW?
30 kW. For the price of it and the automatic start with the generator, that's I used to work at Wright Hennepin, and I was involved with some of the off-peak programs where we do have generators. That is fairly close to a price for a new generator right now.
I just had one put in on my house up north. It's a 1022 kW. It was $8,200.
Okay.
So I think we need to get some more prices.
I'm asking for approval not to exceed, but we will get more quotes.
Yeah, we can do that.
Something doesn't seem right there, but I know it's a bigger one, but Go ahead, Rick.
I understand what you're saying with what's wrong with this one. Was that done by an assessment by some qualified person? And did they send a report? You know, I have a price of a new generator and I can listen to you of how bad it is, but I'd like to see a report of somebody specifying all of these things that you're saying.
Did you get a report from Ziegler? I was up there that day, and again, with my experience as working with generators in the past, he showed me some of that, and we can get a report. He is a certified person for working on generators and things, so that can easily be done.
Okay. I just believe in believe but verify. I'd like to verify that the information we're given is actually...
You said it was 45 years old, right?
It is. It came from, I believe, a Lardy chicken barn somewhere.
That's a long time for a piece of equipment. Yep.
It's an old brush-operated generator, and you don't find those anymore. Yeah. It has brushes in it and things.
Got to be inefficient as hell.
But I can verify when I was on the fire department here, how many times we would test, and let's say in 2 or 3 months, something would fail on it. It wouldn't be the batteries or low or this. So it, and I agree with what Mike said. That is a key hub here for if something goes wrong.
Then and we it can, got us through that bad hair day.
Yeah.
For the windstorm.
Right. So, I mean.
It did work.
That day it worked.
Okay. Mayor, we got a motion.
There's a background on that, and that was the EDA built those two facilities, yeah. Okay. And then there was an FFE, fixtures, furniture, and equipment allowance that was back there. So that's probably why at that time it was bought as a used one. And I, okay. Bob Freeling would be the expert on that.
Not pertinent. Need a motion?
Yes, please.
I'll make a motion to approve getting some more bids, but to not exceed
$25,000.
Second.
Motion been made and second. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed, same. Motion passes.
Thank you.
Yep.
Mr. Mayor, council members, the next item would be Stoney's Bar request for reimbursement of
$18,18.75. Okay. I think the issue here is, did the property owner act reasonably given the information he was given from a city employee that may or not been qualified to give the information that he's given and extended over a number of years. So I think the city is responsible to some level here. The property owner probably gained something here by having some of their equipment replaced. So I think it's, my opinion, it's a matter of determining a percentage responsibility for the city and how much of that bill we're going to pay. And personally, I think the city's more than 50-50 responsible, up to maybe 75%. But
I don't know, Jeff, if I would. I mean, they did put in a larger size, mm-hmm. and there is a benefit. It's got brand new.
But I guess I'm looking at the cost of it, too, when I say that percentage. When you look at what property owners gain, is it gained a quarter-inch pipe? But if you look at, I don't have that in front of me, but the pipe cost was like $300, and probably the digging out's going to be maybe $275, a couple hundred. So the expensive part, you know, is not where the property owner gained. So that's why I came up with the... So I'm looking at a dollar amount, not the, you know, the decision, 50-50 responsibility. So I'd be open to anything from 50 to 75%, I guess.
Yeah, the fitting and the pipe come up to $350.
Yeah.
So that's the rest of it is the backhoe and the labor.
So that part's like 20% of the $1,800 plus the back, you know, if you allocate something for the backhoeing. To which he would have had to pay for if he had that pipe replaced himself. So.
Gino, do you know what the backhoe cost was? Did he break it down for you?
Yeah, it's in the
it's in the
almost $1,500.
Okay.
$906.25 for two-man crew on the 30th of June, and $562 the day before, and there was a lackluster effort of dewatering the first time around. I visited the site, and so of this here, and it's probably not necessarily the fact that it's Stoney's Bar, but the individual that was hired by private enterprise was probably not qualified to have the work done with the equipment that they had or something like that. Happens to be a personal friend, so there's nothing personal about that, but the type of equipment that it takes is like Geisinger's have or something like that. So
do you think that bill is higher as a result of having somebody not with the right equipment?
Very much so. That,
you think so?
Yep.
Okay. Do you have any idea what that would might have cost if it was?
Well, Mr. Mayor, you alluded to 50% right out of the get-go, and I said, you know, that's exactly the number I had in my mind. So if there was this bill and we're going to split it 50-50, that the owner takes care of half of it and the city takes care of a half of it, I could live with that after a while. It's just tough.
I'm going to make that a motion.
You want to make that motion?
I will, if you want.
Okay,
yeah.
I'll second it.
Okay, motion been made and second to pay for the city to pay 50% of this bill. All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Opposed, same. Motion
nay.
Passes.
I think it should be more.
We should pay more?
Yeah.
Can we roll, please, for the record?
Well,
4-1, I guess. Do you want to reconsider? No? Okay.
I think you motion 50%, 50-75%, I think it's in there. It could be more, but we don't know.
And the reason I feel that this could be an avalanche that would start off, because the next one will say, oh, by the way, you did it for that one, so the next one that comes along, it's a procedure that Marty talked about earlier or something like that that happened. So the next guy that comes along said, hey, I have a lack of water coming in, and we changed the gate valve and that, and said, well, it must be going on in, but you gave it for the other one, so why don't you give me a new one too or something like that. Where does it stop? Where does it stop?
Just so you know, councilors are not bound by the term precedent.
I realize that.
That's what I'm just saying.
The public doesn't understand precedence.
Yep.
No, I think we need to stick with a procedure now. Whenever somebody comes, like you're doing, they go out and they investigate, and we stick with that.
Absolutely.
Right. Yeah. Maybe just to reiterate publicly, if somebody has an issue, they need to contact City Hall first before any work is done.
Correct.
In the spirited conversation that the administrator and I have, we'll have that as a big portion of that debate.
And I just want to remember, you know, point out that he had been for years through multiple public works employees, been trying to work with the city. Right.
Marty, do we typically, and I don't know you're new, but do we put out anything in a newsletter in advance of this preliminary tax levy? Or is that something maybe we want to reiterate this policy and procedure and maybe put something in about this potentially 25% tax levy? And
sure.
It timely. Vince, did you have something real quick?
Yes, if I might add, I believe you shouldn't be worried about setting precedent, because I really believe this is a unique situation, because he was told by the city employees that it was his problem. And I guess nobody knows more about flood water lines in this town than I do. We've gone through that many years ago between Gene Rostein and myself. We must have blew out over half of the water lines in town. We did cure about 90% of it. It was a different problem at that time, but I remember two or three of them that we couldn't do anything with, and I think that's not 100% right, but I think that is one of them that we never did fix at that point. And also the dewatering, I would believe, was a big issue on this too.
Okay.
Which is And we put the sewer in, about 90% of the sewer lines in town had to be dewatered, because even you go in Cody's living back there, which people couldn't believe we had to dewater, because it's a 50-foot drop down to the river right next to it. So I don't know if that's how much they paid for the dewatering, but that certainly should entirely be paid for by the city.
Okay, thank you, Ben.
That's just my opinion.
Yeah. Okay, next item, Marty. Anything?
Mr. Mayor and council members, I forwarded you a brief email yesterday that we had a liquor compliance check failure. And so I spoke with the owner. He acknowledged the failure. I informed him of his rights to have a hearing and contest it. He didn't indicate that that was what he needed to do. He was surprised by the state standards, the minimums. And so on your dais table, I placed a resolution, and it has in there the state minimums. State minimum that you can impose is a one-day suspension and a $500 fine. You don't have the authority to tell that to deviate from the state. You can increase the fine, and you can add other stipulations if you so desire. I asked him to call me. I told him that I'd like to just address it, nip it in the bud, and move on. And so if you're willing to do that, I have that resolution for you to act on. And if not, it can wait another month, too.
I don't think we have a choice.
We do have some flexibility. And in the basic code, it states the following. The following is the minimum schedule for presumptive civil penalties in which imposed on the addition to any suspended unless the license is revoked. In this case, for the first violation with any 3 years, $500. That's mandated. The flexibility, and that is on the next page of the basic code under section 1, subsection, or section 2, bullet A. For the first violation with any 3 year period, at least a one-day suspension in addition to any of the civil penalties may be imposed. It's not shall. It may be imposed. And I called the league on that to get a verification on that today. But we did have a $500 plus a one-day suspension for the previous one. And so, again, if we're trying to treat everybody equal, that's probably what we should be doing. We don't have a choice on the $500. And the last time, if you recall, we gave the individual that is the proprietor the day that they wanted to have as their choice of the day of suspension. That's what we did with the...
I have to say I'm a little confused by what you just said. But
It's in our, it's right in the, it's on our webpage.
But I'll make the motion for resolution 2016-37.
Which includes?
$500 fine and a 1 day suspension.
I'll second that.
Sorry, Sue, did you say it is not an and, it is a may? Where are you reading it?
Right there.
No, about the...
The 1 day.
At least a 1 day suspension. Okay. But you, when you read it off, you said $500.
Mandated. Yep.
Mandated.
That's a $500 we can't change.
You may impose a 1 day or you shall impose.
And that was a staff person at the league. I called to verify it. He said, but you might want to call your attorney. And I'm just merely saying that we have that option as far as I understand it. But it really becomes a moot issue. The motion on the table is to go with the $500 and the 1 day suspension.
Well, for the record, Attorney Ripple has stated that this is the minimum, 500 and 1 day.
Okay.
So we have a, all right. I just want to make sure that we don't have a resolution drafted here that's contrary to what the statute's saying. So you have a motion that follows this resolution?
Yes.
Been made and seconded?
Yeah.
Okay, all in favor, say aye.
I was just saying, I think you were reading what's in our basic code on our website.
Right.
Right.
Oh.
Yeah.
I thought you were reading off this.
No, this is the basic code that we, a number of years ago, the state modified that, and the basic code is for layman's language to understand it.
Okay, well, then we should correct this if there's any discrepancy between this and the statute. So motion's been made and second. All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Opposed, same. Motion passes.
I believe that's all I have, Mr. Mayor.
Under other, could I just give a brief update? The issue that we're having with the Lake Roadhouse properly, well, fall, you know, loosely termed the Castaway House, has progressed. They have all the siding on. They're working on it great. So everything is going in the right direction. The neighbors that I've talked to are very pleased. So
good.
Yeah. So we don't have to do any. We gave the administrator the right to go forward, didn't need to?
We have it on the agenda for next month to discuss the progress, but there's three vehicles that are unlicensed there, but that'll be brought up next month.
I believe Member Wellenbring is talking about the other one with the dilapidated house.
Right, yeah.
That is moving forward.
Okay.
It is. Well, that's the one that we gave you to move to go ahead on. Okay, very good.
Okay, open forum.
Member Wellenbring, did you want to mention Friday's meeting?
Oh, yes, thank you. There is we're hosting, when I say we, meaning the City of Rockville facility right here for the second, Mill Creek E. coli, high E. coli nutrient reduction program spearheaded with MPCA, the Stearns County, and the City of Rockville, Sauk River Watershed District, multitude of people. Should have gone out. Rick was there. Bill, there's a number of people from Rockville that are serving in that capacity. So thanks for reminding me. It's open to the public.
Time?
Yeah, 2 to 4. 2 p.m. to 4 p.m. I believe the St. Cloud Times stated that it was, oh no, I think Tootie had it in her.
1 to 2:30.
I think it's 1 to 2:30 or 1 to 3, and she said it might go past 3.
This is on Friday.
Yeah.
Okay, then it's, then my information, because I have it from 2 to 4. Okay.
Is it 1 or 2 now?
I'll look into adjourn and back to you.
I'll make a motion to adjourn.
I'll second that.
Motion made and second. All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
All the same. Motion passes.